On today's show,
Celtics Wizards predictions, the LA Clippers blow it up decision, and whether the Warriors will sweep the Jazz.
With Paul Pierce playing his final game, we count down our top five truth memories.
And we break down the Kawhi versus Harden matchup in the upcoming Spurs-Rockets series.
It's Monday, May 1st. The starter starts now.
Good evening, Sweet World, and welcome to The Starters, presented by Jack Daniel's Tennessee Honey. Whether you're listening to the podcast, joining us live right now on NBA TV, or a little bit later on YouTube, we're very, very happy to have you. I'm Jamie Skeets, and alongside me, as always, that's Tass Mellis.
Thank you for joining us.
To his right, it's the international man of mystery, taking it to the max, Lee Ellis.
Friend.
Lily.
Lily, and last, certainly not least, over yonder, it is the bearded one, it's Trey Kirby.
Hey-o!
Trey, what do you got, man?
Well, I'm here at the internet looking for your best tweets at hashtag TheStarters, and guys, sometimes a bad dunk contest dunk is just as much fun as a good one. That's exactly what happened over the weekend in the Philippine Basketball Association. This is Jammer Jamito.
What?
Setting up for an over-the-guy dunk and just jumping to the side of him.
What's his name?
Jammer Jamito. And this is Lee Ellis in the 2015 Starters Dunk Contest, blatantly jumping to the side of our producer, Matty O, then trying to tell everybody he jumped over him. So this is where you at home come in. Go to our Twitter page, at The Starters. We've got a poll up right now where you can vote which fake jump over a guy dunk was better. Get your votes in. I'll let you decide what better means, but vote now. We'll check out the results a little bit later. And if you have a tweet to send us, it's hashtag The Starters.
All right, get
check
those
out
tweets
those
in.
Hops, man.
Yeah.
Man, our producer,
yeah,
Matt
that guy jumps.
Oh, our producer, Matt Yo, is huge. Yeah, he's massive. All right, look, we got a fun show tonight. We're going to count down our top five Paul Pierce memories, seeing as he's played his last game in the NBA. And we'll look ahead to tonight's two new series in Cleveland and San Antonio. But we start with a little true or false playoffs edition, looking back at the NBA weekend. Trey, you got the true or false questions. Go at it.
No doubt. The Wizards took a 16-0 lead to start game one of their series with the Celtics. Then things took a turn. Markieff Morris rolled his ankle on Al Horford's foot, and Boston won the second and third quarters by a combined 30 points on their way to a game one win. That's bad news for you guys, because you all took the Wizards to win the series in six games. Well, I was the only one to pick the Celtics, taking them in seven games. Guys, true or false? You want to change your Wizards in six prediction?
Nah, come on. I'm not
changing.
You get
a mulligan, man.
No, I'm not doing it quite yet, because if Markieff Morris was out for the entire series, I would think about changing it. But he says he's going back in game two. The truth is, Al Horford's a dirty player. Did you see him get his... I'm just kidding. I'm kidding, wow. Obviously. Did you see... That wasn't even a topic of conversation, because there's no possible way Al Horford did that on purpose. That being said, it changed the entire game, because that's their advantage in this series, is the boards. They grabbed 30.4% of available offensive rebounds this year against the Boston Celtics. Their best mark against any opponent, and 21 second chance points against the Celtics. Again, their best against any opponent. They're just bigger, and they changed... That changed not only offensively, but defensively. Mm-hmm. He just helps out so much.
I thought that the Wizards started very well. Obviously, they got off to a great 16-0 lead. Yeah. But then they kind of lost focus a little bit. And we do see this from the Wizards in the playoffs a little bit. And the Celtics pounced. You know, once they got their first couple of baskets, you could sort of see the momentum. The crowd gets into it. Isaiah Thomas took over. Horford was great. Crowder was great. But I think if the Wizards lock in and don't let those bad moments happen, those bad runs happen, I think they can easily get back into this game. But they just sort of, they get down and then they just kind of, I wouldn't say they gave up, but they just didn't have that same fight that they showed early on. And
so you're going false as well?
Yeah, I'm going false too.
Give me a true. Honestly, because you're right. Now, Morris says he's going to play, and we'll see how much he's hampered. Because he could play, it doesn't mean he's going to be
all... It was a bad turn.
Yeah, he thought he may have broke it at first. It was a really gross turn. But even if he plays, he could be hampered. And this squad, the Wizards, they rely more on their starting five than any other team left in the playoffs. Those guys played a ton of minutes together earlier this year, and obviously in the first round of Wall, Beal, Porter, Morris, and Gortat. If he's hampered or can't play for whatever reason, you know, their depth, which is already pretty thin, shallow, pretty thin, comes even to play even more, because then Kelly's bumped up there, and then you're giving Jason Smith probably more minutes. So I would say true, but it does sort of hinge on what type of Morris. Why can't we just get Marcus Morris?
Yes.
Who would know? Mm-hmm. He could just play.
No, he was wearing the jersey in the first series, so he probably could slip in there.
My worry is that they will regret giving up this monstrous lead and shooting basically 50% from the free throw line and giving this one away a little later in the series. Maybe it's in the back of their head that this was the game to get in Boston. That being said, I just think they're such a good team, not ready to pull the plug quite yet. I think Al Horford was the guy who kind of made this go at the end of the game, because the Wizards were coming back. It felt like they were going to make, you know, a run where they were going to take the lead in the fourth quarter. But then Al Horford was the steady veteran hand that came in. He was the second ball handler, as you see him bringing the ball up from the backcourt. He had a near triple-double, 10 of 13 shooting. I thought he was the key to just sort of calming everybody down in the fourth quarter when the Wizards were making another run. Because you got to remember, the Celtics team is only there for the first time in the second round.
They also shot 19 of 39 on threes, the Celtics, which is great.
That's wild.
Huge.
But we saw that against the Bulls sometimes. When their shots are off, that can really cost them. So I don't expect them to shoot quite that well for the rest of the series. But when they do have games like that, they are tough to beat.
Ultimately, still think this will be a long series.
Yeah, I think so.
Six or seven for either of these teams. All right, Trey, next one.
All right, moving on. After the Clippers' Game 7 home loss to the Jazz, in the sixth season since Chris Paul joined the team, they have a postseason record of 24-33 while famously never getting past the second round. CP3, Blake Griffin, and JJ Redick can all be free agents this summer, and you're going to hear this a lot. True or false, the Clippers should blow it up.
You're going to hear this a lot. What does blow it up really mean? I think it is true if that means maybe not running back this exact same squad. Of course, Chris Paul, Blake Griffin, maybe even JJ. I don't think that should happen. I don't even think it will happen. So I guess true. And I can't take another sort of Clippers sort of meltdown. Whatever the clip's going to clip, it's the Clippers curse, whatever you want to put on it. It's tough to watch. It is. I'm in a weird way, I was happy they lost Game 7 just to see if the Jazz can put up a fight against the Warriors, because I don't think I could see the Warriors running the Clips out of the building again, especially with the Blake Griffin injury.
But I think it's false, because why wouldn't you sign these guys to long-term deals and then potentially trade them and get something back for them? If I'm Doc Rivers, the GM, I want some value back for my young guys so I can be Doc Rivers, the coach, with some actual talented guys. You can't just let them leave, even if they...
What if Blake Griffin wants to leave?
I convince
Chris, I don't see going anywhere because that $200 million is going to be in play.
Right.
But Blake may want to leave.
He may.
All three of them may want to, but I say, hey, sign a max deal, make a lot of money, and then possibly trade him. Because they'll all be tradable, obviously.
Yeah, I still would keep those three together, Blake, DeAndre, and Chris Paul. The problem with the Clippers remains their depth. They haven't done a good job surrounding those guys with talent. But if you have an opportunity to sign all-star talent, all-NBA talent, I don't think you let that walk for
Even
free.
If that all-NBA talent, in Blake Griffin's case, can't play half the time?
Well, we know that it tends to end this way for the Clippers in the season. Something goes wrong for them. But again, you've got to try to at least, when you've got those assets, you want to hold on to those, I think, as long as possible. Surround them with better talent. And again, you just have to hope things go better as far as the bad luck and the curses that the Clippers have. But I wouldn't let those guys just walk for free unless you're guaranteed someone free agent signing coming in who's going to be better than those guys.
I mean, we know Steve Ballmer's got deep pockets.
Yeah.
So if he wants to go into the luxury tax and start paying that repeater tax, he could do it if he wants to.
But again,
if
you're a free agent and Chris Paul's left and Blake left, and it's like, do you want to go into a situation then when perhaps you are a good player, but they, again, don't have a quality support team around those guys?
But so is it a good season to you if the Clippers win 50 games and then lose in the first or second round?
Well,
every year?
Obviously, you expect more from them. But again, how many teams would love to be in the playoffs at least every single year in contention for a top four spot? A lot of teams would take that.
Yeah, we'll see. All right, Trey, final one.
All right, thanks to the Jazz playing seven games in their first round series and the Warriors needing just four to sweep the Blazers. You might have forgotten Golden State was even still in the playoffs, but they are, I checked. Dubs haven't played in a week, and Game 1 versus Utah isn't until tomorrow night in the Roracle. So, true or false, the Warriors are going to sweep the Jazz.
Ooh, this reminds me of a couple years ago when the Warriors played the Grizzlies, because right now the Warriors are the fourth fastest pace in the league. The Jazz are the slowest. Back then in 2015, it was, again, a battle of paces. And the Grizzlies really slowed it down and got the Warriors rattled. But that was before they won their first championship. That's when they just didn't have it all together. At this point, I don't think you can rattle them by slowing it down. So I don't think it's going to be a sweep. But the Jazz are in tough. Very tough.
Yeah, yeah. No one's going to be picking the Jazz to win this series. I don't even think most Jazz fans would.
I mean, the Jazz, obviously, their best chance is to protect home court, make things difficult for them.
Muck it up, though, like Tass
exactly,
is saying. Like,
yeah.
Just get this down to a super slow game. Have Joe Johnson and Gordon Hayward try and get you buckets in the half court. The only problem with that is the Warriors are great defensively in a half-court setting, too.
They can match anything that the Jazz can throw at them.
That's sort of true. You know,
But I mean, we saw a pretty resilient Jazz team. I mean, let's not forget, they lost Rudy Gobert for basically the first three games of this series, and they still pulled out a road victory at Game 7.
Yeah.
Double digits.
Yeah, against a very good, you know, at times, Clippers team. Yeah. So they've proven that they can actually hang tough with teams. Right now, though, the challenge is, of course, the Warriors, we just think they're just going to walk out there and destroy anybody pretty much right now. They have to find a way to slow them down. Maybe the rust versus rest factor comes into play a little bit, at least for Game 1. Right. Jazz will be hoping for that.
So we're all saying no sweep.
No sweep.
But it sure sounds like we're talking 5 or 6 here. Let's get to the ultimate predictions. We'll throw Trey's up there as well. The Jazz Warriors predictions. Okay, yeah, a lot of bridges. Everybody says Warriors in 5.
Bunch of wimps.
Yeah.
Couldn't pick a sweep. We couldn't do it.
You couldn't do it? I got too much respect for the Jazz. Well, I think they are going to take a game. I think they are. Whether it's a gentleman sweep or maybe it's game 3, we will see. It's not a tough place to win, obviously, in Utah either. All right, we got to take a break, though. When we come back, we say goodbye to Paul Pierce's 19-year career. Don't go anywhere. Back with the starters. Paul Pierce's 19-year career came to an end on Sunday when the Clips lost to the Jazz in their first-round series. The truth, the 10-time All-Star finished with over 26,000 points. So as a small token of our appreciation to Paul Pierce, we're going to count down our favorite truth memories.
At number 5, it's the origin of the truth nickname. In only his third season, way back in 01, Pierce's Celtics, taking on Shaq's Lakers, put 42 on L.A., and that's when Shaq labeled Pierce with a moniker that would never leave him.
Write this down. Paul Pierce is the mother truth.
Self-edited.
It stuck. More times than not, Paul Pierce, he came through in the clutch. Helped the Celtics rally from a 26-point deficit versus the Nets in the 2002 East Finals. Scored 19 of his 28 in the final period. He was on fire.
Wasn't always pretty, but the shots were going in.
They were going in. He had some unbelievable battles versus LeBron James in the playoffs. Specifically 2008 in the East Semis, where he scored 41 to help eliminate LeBron and the Cavs, moving them on to the East Finals. And they would have a pretty good season that year, winning the title. Yeah, not bad. Also in the regular season, some big shots. Our favorite, Inda Gaddin. Oh. Step back against the Knicks.
No push-off.
Nate Robinson was pumped. Nate Robinson was very pumped.
One jump's not enough.
No.
Whoa!
There he goes. Just running around. Him. And then who can forget this buzzer beater versus the Hawks in the 2015 playoffs? The shot was great. It was definitely great. But the post-game interview, it may have been better.
Did you call bank? I called game.
Oh, what a line.
At number 3, this guy just loves Halloween. Halloween is our third memory. He dressed as a frog. He dressed as Buzz Lightyear. He dressed as the professor from the Powerpuff Girls.
Great family.
Got his whole family involved.
He commits.
Dressed as Captain America. Marcin Gortat is dressed as a wizard there. He was the Tin Man from the Wizard of Oz family. They're all joining in. Captain Hook, again, the Peter Pan family in there as well. And just this past Halloween, he was Rick James at the game.
Same wig as his Captain Hook. Love it.
In February, Pierce made his final appearance in Boston, a city where he spent 15 seasons, became a Celtics legend. Fans gave Pierce a huge ovation during pregame introductions. He kissed the leprechaun, the logo there. And then with about 20 seconds to go, the fans were chanting for him to enter the game. He did, and he delivered, hitting a meaningless three, but a pretty cool moment at the end of the game with about 11 seconds left. Deafening roar from the crowd. It was his only basket of the game, too.
That was awesome.
Crazy.
That was a great, great moment. But at number 1, he brought the 17th championship home to Boston. It didn't look extremely promising to start. Third quarter of game 1, he went down in a heap. It looked like a very bad knee injury. Mm-hmm. We remember him going to the locker room and this infamous shot in the wheelchair. But minutes later, he comes out of the tunnel.
There he comes.
It's not quite Willis Reed, but it was a very, very cool moment. And how could they lose after that? He had a couple big, big threes in the third quarter there. He went on for 22 points, 7-10 shooting. They won game 1.
Amazing.
They obviously went on to win the series. And Paul Pierce holding the trophy there, also holding another trophy, was named Finals MVP.
Congratulations to Paul Pierce on an unbelievable career.
Yeah.
19 years, I've said, is no joke. I guess a question I throw at everyone watching you guys here, is he a first ballot Hall of Famer? I think we all agree he's a Hall of Famer. Is he first ballot? In on the first
lock go. It in.
Lock it in.
So. I think so. 10 All-Star games. I think the championship and the finals MVP certainly helps his case. But, you know, 26,000 points, as you mentioned. He did a
15th
lot.
15th all-time.
I'd be surprised if he doesn't get in straight away.
What was your favorite part of, like, Paul Pierce's game? Is it just, like, the footwork? Is it sort of that old man game where he wasn't the most athletic guy out there but could get
it done? That's got to be the footwork, and it's got to specifically be the step back. We saw all those clips, and 90% of them, he's shooting a step back to the right, which you don't see very often. But that was Paul Pierce's move. If he could get to that right elbow, you were done for.
Mm-hmm. I just liked as well how his career, as it progressed, he understood that he became a bit of a bench player and a role player, but he still delivered in the clutch as well. As Raptors fans, you know, he hurt you guys
a few times. You don't need to bring that up.
But seriously, though, a lot of guys can't handle that part of their career where they're like, they're no longer the star, they're no longer the first guy on the team who's getting all the shots. But when the game's on the line, that he was always out on the floor.
Did it bother you that he sort of bounced around near the end of his career playing on the Nets and the Wizards and the Clips and so on?
No, it wasn't his choice to get moved from the first place.
Good point.
He probably would have been a lifelong Celtic if he had his first choice.
Right.
All right, well, let's have moments with all those teams he played on.
Yeah.
You guys, I'm sure, are
the
familiar
Wizards,
with those teams.
Of course.
Yeah. Killing the Raptors left and right. Well, let's hear from you guys. Jump on Twitter, hashtag the starters. Is Paul Pierce a first ballot Hall of Famer? All right, after the jump, we're going to look ahead to tonight's NBA action, including whether the Raps can finally stop LeBron.
The Starters on NBA TV is brought to you by Jack Daniel's Tennessee Honey, proud partner of the NBA. Do your friends proud. Please drink responsibly.
A couple other semifinal matchups getting started tonight. A couple game ones here on TNT getting underway at 7 p.m. Eastern. Coverage, though, right after the Starters here. Don't go anywhere on NBA TV. We've got Raps and Cavs game one, followed by the Rockets and Spurs. Very excited for both of these series. Time for a little look ahead. Trey, you got some questions heading into these games and, of course, in these series in general. Take it away.
Yep, Cavs, Raptors, game one is tonight. One team has LeBron James and one team keeps bringing in guys to try and defend LeBron James. What's the key to this series?
Yeah, that guy who they have brought in. Last year, LeBron and Kyrie would just put a Raptors center in the pick and roll. The Raptors center would just get lost sort of out on the perimeter or just be too slow to get back. The D would have to collapse. Those two guys would just find three-point shooters, and the three-point shots came raining down. They'd try and throw in Patrick Patterson at the five just to be a little bit quicker and more mobile. But then LeBron just decided, well, I can go over this guy and score at the rim. So that's where Serge Ibaka comes in. He can be both those guys, the guy who can help out on the perimeter to sort of, you know, shield off the drivers, or at the rim, he can deter guys. He can make LeBron and Kyrie think twice. I think Serge Ibaka is the key to this series defensively. The offense is a whole other issue, but defensively, Serge Ibaka has to really be all over the place. Even if they do start big with Jonas Valanciunas and Serge Ibaka at 5-4, Serge Ibaka is going to finish these games. Right. He's got to be monstrous defensively.
I think the Raptors do have to stay at home on LeBron and just make sure those other shooters don't get good looks. Even though LeBron's going to get all the points he wants in that situation, occasionally throw the doubles at him. But when the Cavs are at their best, everyone's involved in the offense. Everyone's getting shots. Everyone's getting looks. I honestly think the Pacers did it a couple of times where they just said, you know what, whoever's on LeBron, stay with him, because we don't want these other guys to get going.
They still average 13.5 threes per game against the Pacers.
It doesn't really matter what you do, because we know how good LeBron is at anyway getting guys involved. But for me, I think that's probably the smartest way to defend him.
I would agree with you. I mean, and what Tass said, I mean, it goes all hand in hand here.
Yeah.
How Ibaka plays and whether or not these guys get open looks. These are the numbers last year in the East Finals when the Cavs and the Raptors matched up. You know, JR hit 18 threes. Fry hit 14 threes. He was massive.
See, that's the thing. LeBron and Kyrie didn't kill him.
No.
These other guys who did it.
So you got to try and take that away. And I think, you know, offensively, we can just very quickly touch on this. Kyle Lowry needs to be better than 14-5, like what he was against the Bucks. For them to have any chance to make this competitive or even, like, somehow give us a game seven, Kyle Lowry's got to be one of the better players out there, you know, a step ahead of a Kyrie and stuff like that. Got to make him work on that end as well. So should be interesting, but Ibaka is a huge piece with this one. All right, Trey, next one.
Deep in the heart of Texas, two MVP candidates will duel as the Spurs and Rockets face off in game one tonight. Guys, who's the best player in this series? Davis Bertans?
Ooh, is it Bertans?
Montrezl Harrell?
What do you think?
I think Kawhi Leonard isn't going out like he went out last year. If you remember round two against the Thunder, he kind of slowed down a little bit. Slowing down for, you know, a great player means 20 points per game in the four losses. He set his playoff career high twice in the first round this year. We got to remember, he's 25. He's only getting better. I think we're going to see the best Kawhi Leonard that we've ever seen. He had a 37-point game, then he had a 43-point game against the Grizzlies in round one. I think in this series, he will likely be the best offensive player.
And are you going to save him defensively until fourth quarter action to put on James Harden? You're going to start Danny Green and you're going to run other guys at him and save that.
I think so. Yeah, that's what they've done in the past, and it only makes sense. Danny Green's a great defender,
right,
and he's extremely long. I think that'll be the method out on the perimeter. Danny Green, just stick with James Harden, but don't stick your hand in. Stick with him, don't stick it in.
Yeah, and James Harden obviously is the other best player in this series, and what he does dictates so much of what the Rockets do as well. Whether he goes in the pick and roll and attacks the Pau Gasols and LaMarcus Aldridge, or if he's shooting threes. But either way, the Rockets need to get better shooting of three-pointers from their support cast as well. They only shot 29.2% against the Thunder in that first round, but they kind of got away with it because the Thunder weren't able to punish them for it. Mm-hmm. You know the Spurs, if you shoot badly against them, they will punish you. They'll make it a slower game if they need to. The Rockets have to score a lot of points, I think, if that's their best chance to beat.
Yeah, what's weird about that, though, like in the regular season matchups, it was really, really tight there. All those games were close, and the Rockets didn't shoot the ball well, and they didn't shoot the ball well in the first round, like you said. I mean, if those threes start falling, the Rockets could run away with a few of these games. And we were torn on this one. We had two guys going Spurs, two guys going Rockets. I know a lot of people out there are torn, so it should be a great series. I'm very looking forward to it. All right, we got to take one more break when we come back. Lily, you going to hit us with a VSP?
Oh, I am. You betcha.
Okay. You're watching The Starters, presented by Jack Daniel's Tennessee Honey.
Well, that was a nice one.
You betcha. We asked you guys, which fake jump over a guy dunk was better? This guy, Jammer, in the Philippines.
Jammer.
Just going around a guy, most ironic name ever. Or Lily, going around Starters producer Matty O.
72% of people think Lee Ellis is the better fake jump over a guy, mostly because you did a better job of hiding that you didn't jump over. That seems to be the reason.
Yeah.
I guess.
Smart fans.
Lily, where are we going for VSP?
We are heading out to Staples for a gorgeous netball play off the inbounds pass here from the Utah Jazz. Gordon Hayward starts it, then Bobo near the Bobo finishes it.
Now, why is this a netball again?
Because no one dribbles it.
Okay.
You're not allowed to dribble it yourself in netball.
Smart.
You are allowed a bounce pass, and that's gorgeous. That's what I call a very solid play.
Great one. Like that. Tomorrow morning, guys, you got to join us live on Twitter. 11 a.m. Eastern, it's the Starters Twitter show. Always a blast. Get your questions in right now. Hashtag the Starters. You can email us if you want, thestarters@nba.com. Always a lot of fun. Who's got top five duty tomorrow? Well, we gotta decide.
Nobody knows.
All right.
What a mystery.
Again, quick reminder, tonight's TNT doubleheader. It's Raptors and Cavs. Raps about to shock the world.
Just a little lapse.
Followed by the Rockets and the Spurs. Hey, the Cavs might be rusty. We don't know.
Yeah.
It might be rusty. So enjoy those. We'll be back tomorrow, 6:30 p.m. Eastern.
Seven games would be a shock, unfortunately.
It's happening.
Looking forward to it. All right, thanks for joining us, folks. And remember, this is how you jump over someone and throw down a dunk.
Get them to sit down. Helps. Embrace the night, people.